The Islamic Foundation presents Preparing for Ramadan, Part 3.
بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله حمدا يوافي نعمه ويكافئ مزيده وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له وأشهد أن سيدنا ونبينا وقدوتنا محمدا عبده ورسوله صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم تسليما كثيرا أما بعد. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah, everyone. I hope you're all doing really well. I hope you're taking care of yourselves, and I hope that inshallah we're all preparing ourselves for the month of Ramadan that will begin inshallah in about a week's time. May Allah ta'ala allow us to reach the month of Ramadan, and may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala allow us to take advantage of it, and may Allah ta'ala allow us to make it the best Ramadan of our lives. Ameen. So today we're going to continue in our discussion of preparing for the month of Ramadan. And the topic of discussion today is the Qur'an. And to begin, I'd like to allude to something I referred to earlier in our series. And that is the ayah in which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, شَهْرُ رَمَضَانَ الَّذِي أُنزِلَ فِيهِ الْقُرْآنِ. The month of Ramadan in which the Qur'an was revealed. Now, this is a very interesting selection of words by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Because think about it, the month of Ramadan, the only obligation in the month of Ramadan is Siyam. That's the only obligation. That's the only fard component of the month of Ramadan. Yet Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala does not refer to the month of Ramadan as the month in which fasting has been ordained or made obligated. Allah refers to it as the month in which the Qur'an was revealed. Allah Azza wa Jalla says, إِنَّا أَنزَلْنَاهُ فِي لَيْلَةٍ مُبَارَكَةٍ. Indeed, we have revealed the Qur'an on a blessed night, يعني ليلة القدر. And Allah says, إِنَّا أَنزَلْنَاهُ فِي لَيْلَةِ الْقَدْرِ. And so the association of the Qur'an with the month of Ramadan is very, very high. The month of Ramadan and the Qur'an are intertwined together from its onset, from the beginning. Allah Azza wa Jalla, like I mentioned, said, إِنَّا أَنزَلْنَاهُ فِي لَيْلَةِ الْقَدْرِ. But what does Ibn Abbas radiallahu anhu say? Ibn Abbas details that further. And he is the greatest mufassir of the Qur'an, the cousin of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam. And he says that Allah Azza wa Jal revealed the Qur'an in its entirety, from beginning to end, from the Lawh al-Mahfuz to a place in the first heaven known as Baytul Izzah. So the Qur'an was revealed in its entirety to the first heaven on Laylatul Qadr, to the first heaven, to the Baytul Izzah. And from there, Jibreel alayhi salam would take revelations to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam throughout his lifetime, throughout the 23 years of revelation, according to the circumstances and according to what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala willed. And so the first of these revelations also came in the month of Ramadan. On the Laylatul Qadr, Jibreel came to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam in the Ghar Hira, and he said to him, Iqra. And then the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam responded, Ma ana biqari, I'm not of those who recite. And then Jibreel embraced him, and we all know the story. And then the first ayahs of Surah Al-Alaq were revealed, Iqra bismi rabbika alladhi khalaq. خلق الإنسان من علق اقرأ وربك الأكرم الذي علم بالقلم علم الإنسان ما لم يعلم. And this was the first revelation that was given to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And so we see from these incidences and these ayat that the relationship with the Quran and the month of Ramadan is very strong, and it is the reason why we are able to recite the Quran with such fervor during this month. Because outside of the month of Ramadan, it is more difficult. Naturally, it is more difficult. But in the month of Ramadan, there is a barakah associated with the month itself that allows us to recite the Qur'an more often, and to recite it with more excitement, and to recite it with continuous devotion. And that is because of the relationship between the month of Ramadan and the Qur'an. And so we find in our history that the Salaf, the righteous predecessors that came before us, they would devote their entire time during this month to the Qur'an. We find number one, Imam Malik rahimahullah. Imam Malik, what he would do during this time, as he was a great scholar of hadith, he would narrate hadith, he is the author of the Muwatta. He related all of those ahadith with his chain of narration. But during this time, he would leave that aside. And he would devote himself to reciting the book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That he would devote this whole month of Ramadan to doing nothing else but reciting the Qur'an. And we find similarly that Imam Shafi'i rahimahullah, during this month, would complete 60 completions of the Qur'an. 60. It's not even an exaggeration. 60 completions of the Qur'an he would complete outside of Salah. So his whole day would revolve around reciting the Quran during the month of Ramadan. It's reported that Imam Abu Hanifa would do the same. It's reported from a lot of our later scholars who came even closer to our time, that they would devote their entire day to the Quran. They would not really take visitors, and that they would really just devote their entire time to reciting the Quran during this blessed month. And so we should make it a habit of our own that during this time, that during this Ramadan, that we should really, really take out the day, take out the time to really recite the Quran. The Quran should be our priority during this month. We may do other adhkar, make tasbih, tahmid, tahleel, say subhanallah, alhamdulillah, Allahu Akbar, send salawat upon the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. That's all great and fine. But really, this month should be devoted to recitation of the Quran. And we should make it we should not really make an obligation upon ourselves, but make it a goal for ourselves. Make it a goal that at the end of the month, we will at least, at the bare minimum, have made one khatma of the Quran. And inshallah, we'll find great reward in this. And we'll find that really we're taking advantage of the month of Ramadan, because it is the month in which the Quran was revealed. Now, moving on to Salatul Taraweeh. Now, Salatul Taraweeh has its origins in the lifetime of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And so, I would like to narrate a hadith. And for this, I really want you to imagine that you're there when this is happening. Imagine that you are sitting in the masjid of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. After Salatul Isha, it's night time, but the masjid is relatively full. There's a good amount of people. And that on one corner, you have Sahaba making tahajjud. On the other corner, you have people reciting Quran. And then you have dua, people making dua on one side of the masjid, people making adhkar on the other side of the masjid. And then the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam himself enters the masjid from his home. He enters the masjid and the people gather behind him and he leads them in salah. This was the first taraweeh that was prayed during the time of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Now everyone is obviously overjoyed and excited. And so after it's over, the next day, they go and tell their families that the Prophet ﷺ led us in tahajjud, and they tell everyone else, and you know, the message spreads that the Prophet ﷺ led them in salah. And so the next night comes and the masjid is full. The masjid is full of people. And so the Prophet ﷺ again enters the masjid and leads all of them in salatul taraweeh. And then the next night, the message spreads even further. The entirety of Medina knows now. And so they all enter the masjid of the Prophet ﷺ, and the masjid is overflowing with people. But this night, the Prophet ﷺ does not come out. So they're waiting, and they're waiting, and they're waiting. But the Prophet ﷺ does not come out until the time of Fajr. And then he said, I saw you all gathering, and I was afraid that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala would make it fardh upon you, and so I did not come out. And this was the last time that Taraweeh was prayed in the lifetime of the Prophet ﷺ. And it was not made again in jama'ah, with one big jama'ah, until the time of Umar radiallahu anhu. Umar radiallahu anhu one night came into the masjid of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, and he saw that people were praying in various different jama'at. So he saw some people praying here behind one imam, some behind another imam. And he thought that we should make this one jama'ah. So he appointed Ubay ibn Ka'b radiallahu anhu, and the Sahaba radiallahu anhum all gathered behind him. And that's when Salatul Taraweeh was established as we know it, and it has continued from that time until our very day. Until our very day, we have prayed the Taraweeh that started during the time of Umar radiallahu anhu. Now the comparison is really not the same. The Sahaba radiallahu anhum used to pray for long, long periods of the night, such that some of the Sahaba would have to lean on their staffs while they were praying because it was such a long qiyam. But nonetheless, we should continue this habit, this sunnah, of praying Salatul Taraweeh. And just something, a side note to mention, is that following the sunnah of the Sahaba, particularly the Khulafa al-Rashidin, is following the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Our Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam mentioned, عَلَيْكُمْ بِسُنَّتِي, hold on to my sunnah, وَسُنَّةِ الْخُلَفَاءِ الرَّاشِدِينَ الْمَهْدِيِّينَ, and the sunnah of the Khulafa al-Rashidin, the rightly guided Khulafa, Abu Bakr, Umar, Uthman, and Ali, follow their sunnah and hold on to it. عَضُّوا عَلَيْهَا بِالنَّوَاجِدِ, and grasp onto it with your molar teeth, bite onto it and do not leave it. So following their sunnah is following the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and that's something that we should keep in mind and not take for granted. So one of the first things that we should be doing is, despite the fact that the masjids are going to be closed most likely, is that we should continue with our taraweeh at home. Now, generally, it's not going to feel the same. But think about it like this. The Sahaba radiallahu anhum, for most of their lives, did not have taraweeh in the masajid. Their Ramadan did not have taraweeh in the masajid except for a very few nights during the time of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So use that as inspiration. Use that as inspiration to be your best, as the Sahaba were their best during Ramadan, even when there was no salatu taraweeh. So take the time out every night and make taraweeh in your own homes with your own families. Pray however much you want, and then make witr together. And then realize that our Prophet ﷺ said, whoever prays with the Imam until the Imam finishes his salah, كُتِبَ لَهُ قِيَامُ لَيْلَةٍ, that for him it is written the reward of praying the whole night in salah. And so pray taraweeh in your home as you deem fit, and do not abandon the sunnah of the Prophet ﷺ. This is a way to connect with the Qur'an, because the best Qur'an is that which is recited in salah. And taraweeh is one of the best ways to connect with the Qur'an. And so don't just limit yourself to taraweeh either, because taraweeh is wonderful, and this is really the custom of the Muslim Ummah during the time of Ramadan. But after Salatul Taraweeh, don't sleep all the way until the time of right before Fajr, where you eat a couple dates or drink water and then that's your suhoor and then you're done. But wake up even before that. Wake up an hour before suhoor and then make wudu and then pray again. Pray tahajjud again. And realize that this is like a boot camp. You're working hard during this month. You're working hard during this month so you can gain as much reward as you can to maximize the potential that you have been given during this month. Taraweeh is one part of it, but make tahajjud as well. Our Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam would pray, in fact, he would pray the same amount in Ramadan, outside Ramadan. Aisha radiallahu anha reports that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam would pray 11 raka'ah in Ramadan and outside of Ramadan, referring to his tahajjud. And he would pray during this time. And so make it a habit to pray Salatul Qiyam as well, the Salatul Tahajjud. However many raka'ahs that you can, whether 2 raka'ahs, 4 raka'ahs, the sunnah would be 8. So make that a priority as well, that before you make suhoor, wake up early, make wudu and pray tahajjud, and then make your suhoor, and then pray Salatul Fajr. And after Salatul Fajr, devote your time to recitation of the Qur'an. Just sit there and recite. There's no salah after Fajr until shuruq. But spend that time reciting Qur'an. Now, you're going to be tired, it's normal, but there's no other time to do this. Work hard now so that you can relax the rest of the year. Make this a time where you're really pushing yourself to the limits. That's what Ramadan is for. Push yourself to your limits and make sure that you are maximizing the potential of this month. So after Fajr is the most opportune time to recite the Quran. So as we see now that our whole night should be focus on recitation of the Qur'an in some way, shape, or form. And that's how we will take advantage of it. The days are for fasting, the nights are for the Qur'an. Whether it be individual recitation, whether it be through taraweeh, tahajjud, whatever it may be. But really make your nights about the Qur'an. So Salatul Maghrib, make your iftar, and then make Salatul Maghrib. After that, prepare yourself, pray Salatul Isha. And then after that, spend the rest of the night reciting the Qur'an. Sleep if you need to, but do it with the intention that that you're going to wake up for tahajjud. That way, even during that time of sleep, you are being rewarded. So these are all things that we should definitely keep in mind, because this month of Ramadan is all about the Qur'an, and that really should be our focus. Our focus should be the Qur'an during this month. So really take the time out, make it a priority in your day, that even if I'm tired, even if I'm really at the brink and I can't do it anymore, push yourself just a little bit harder and you'll see the gains that you will at the end of the month. You'll find it in your book of good deeds on the day of judgment. You'll find out how much that has benefited you. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has made the Quran tahajjud a means of elevating yourselves to him. And it is a means of gaining closeness to Allah. And it is a means of doing other ibadat as well. Because when you wake up for tahajjud, you'll recite Quran, you'll pray. But you'll also make dua. And that is the most opportune time for dua. So it opens up many doors to many great rewards. And then the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said in a hadith, يُقَالُ لِصَاحِبِ الْقُرْآنِ, it will be said to the sahib of the Quran, the companion of the Quran. Not just a hafiz, not just an alim, but one who held fast to the Quran. And one who really kept it close to him and made it a priority in his life, that on the day of judgment, it will be said to him, iqra, recite, wa rtaqi, and elevate, and rise. ورتل, and recite as you used to recite, كما كنت ترتل في الدنيا, and recite as you used to recite in this world, فإن منزلتك عند آخر آية تقرأها, that your place in Jannah is where you stop reciting. So what a great reward that is, that if you hold fast to the Quran in Ramadan, outside of Ramadan, that it will be said to you on the Day of Judgment to recite, and you will recite as much as just as how you would recite in the world, and that you will be elevated to a maqam until you stop reciting. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala allow us to recite from the beginning of the Quran to the end and rise to the highest maqam, and to be with the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam in Jannah and to gaze upon him. So just to recap really quickly of things that we should be doing. Number one, make one khatma of the Quran during Ramadan. That should be the utmost priority. Do not let that go. Make that the number one priority after your siyam, one khatma of the Quran. Number two, Salatul Taraweeh. Do not abandon Salatul Taraweeh even if there's no Taraweeh in the masjid this year. Make sure Taraweeh is a priority. Make sure you're praying it in your home. Try to pray in Jama'ah if you can. Try to make it individually. But definitely do not leave it. Recite as much Quran as you can, or as much as you know during that time. And remember that during the lifetime of the Prophet ﷺ, the Sahaba did not have it. And so use that as inspiration that during this month you are going to be like the Sahaba radiallahu anhum. And then finally, make the last third of the night a time where you wake up again and then pray even more and recite even more Quran. Make this the month of the Quran. Make this month of primarily the Quran. And then after Salatul Fajr, try to recite then as well, because it's a very opportune time. Allah Azza wa Jal says, Inna Quran al-Fajri kana mashhuda. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala accept from us. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make us from the people of the Quran, those who are his special people, Ahlul Quran, Ahlullahi wa khasatu. The people of the Quran are the people of Allah and his special servants. May Allah ta'ala make us from the people of the Quran. May Allah ta'ala allow us to be from among those who recite it all day and all night and to reflect upon its meanings. And may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala accept this month of Ramadan from us. Ameen. Wa sallallahu ala sayyidina Muhammad wa ala alihi wa sahbihi wa sallam. Walhamdulillahi rabbil alameen.